Welcome to the Everything Actioncast, the official podcast of everythingaction.com.
Hello and welcome to the Everything Actioncast, the podcast for the week of August 5th, 2024. I'm your host, Zach.
I'm your co-host, Chris.
Yeah, and this week, to quote the rap song at the end of this movie, knock, knock, you're about to get shell-shocked. We're talking about the 2014 Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie because it's celebrating its 10th anniversary. And we're also getting a new Turtles animated series. It's out right now if you're hearing this on Paramount Plus, Tales of the TMNT, which is based on the, I think you and I both agree, much superior Mutant Mayhem movie compared to the 2014 movie, Chris?
Wait, this is superior to the Mutant Mayhem?
No, like Mutant Mayhem is superior to 2014, yes. Yeah.
Oh my god, like in a crazy amount of ways.
Yes. Yeah, 2014 is such a weird, because I think this might be it's one of the first things, or like, it's definitely very soon after they sold, like they sold the rights to Nickelodeon. And so they had like Nickelodeon like CG show, and then this came out, but then we also had like the TMNT, like that animated movie, and because that was made before Nickelodeon bought them, like that any sort of like sequels or anything to that movie got canceled, and then we got like the animated series on Nickelodeon, and we got this reboot, which is very, very heavily inspired by, it seems like, the Transformers movie by Michael Bay.
Oh, they could be set in the same universe.
Yes. Maybe that might have been, like, a idea at some point, possibly. But, yeah, Michael Bay, I think a lot of people assume, like, unless, like, oh, he directed this movie along with the Transformers. He executive produced this Turtles movie. Jonathan Liebsman directed the movie. He directed, like, Wrath of the Titans and Texas Battle Los Angeles. But Michael Bay's influence is all over. I think from like the designs of the turtles to like definitely Shredder is very Transformers-esque in this movie. Like he looks like he could just be like a Transformer. like a lot of the humor is very Michael Bay. But yeah, it's another origin story. So once again, back to like no one knows the turtles exist, but there's like this kind of like whispers like these vigilantes are out there, and then like the Foot Clan, who are now, they're not ninjas anymore, they're mercenaries in this movie, and they look like the immortals from 300, like they're like that like elite, the warrior group, like the Persian army group, like the ninjas from the Persian army. They have the exact same like mask on.
They have like the generic like high cheekbone like muscle face.
Yeah, but they're not ninjas. They have guns. Like they're not really doing like ninjutsu.
Yeah, they have like one real ninja on that Foot Clan. It's Karai. Everyone else is not a ninja. Technically, mm-hmm. Shredder looks like a samurai.
Mm-hmm.
So, and William Fichtner's the scientist slash other Shredder that got rewritten.
Yeah, well, spoilers, you find out that he's like the he's like Shredder's apprentice, and he runs like this multi-billion-dollar company, but then he's trying to do this like horrific plan to like somewhat destroy New York City to like make more money. That's his only motivation, apparently. He's like, I'm gonna be so rich. He's like, aren't you already rich? You have like five companies. And you own a skyscraper in New York City, and like a lavish estate somewhere 20 minutes from New York that is like the Alps. That's like one of my biggest questions in this entire movie is like, where the hell is that mansion, and what time of year this movie takes place in? Like, do you have any idea? Like, I mean, you know the area, Chris. Like, where
could that be?
Like they say it's a 20-minute helicopter flight from New York City. Like, where could that possibly be? Where it's snowing, and where it's like a giant mountain like range.
I don't know, like the Adirondacks.
But I mean, even But it's like
even a helicopter ride is like maybe the Bronx. Like helicopter ride isn't like a jet, you know? Even when you come in from like the seaport and you see the helicopters take off, they're going to like down the seaport. Like it's not like a cross town thing where the helicopter can bring you to like. You understand? Like New York also has like a. Two major airports, so you have to avoid those flight paths, and then you have to avoid other helicopters. So there's like safe designated routes to go in New York. So like the fly. No one thinks about how much shit's in the air. So it's strange.
But then it's also like April and Vern, who's played by Will Arnett, they drive there twice in a van. So it's within driving distance of New York City, and also there's sewers that connect it to New York City. So it's like
how the like if that is the Adirondacks, if they're saying somehow the Adirondacks somehow look like Colorado,
mm-hmm.
or looks like that part of California that has mountains.
But it's like, also but also like
different trees.
Yeah, but also it doesn't seem like it's winter. Like New York City does not seem like it's winter.
It's like summer. Like spring in New York.
Yeah,
because for some reason, that peak that they're going to looks like it's in the Alps.
It's like where is full. There's like a foot of snow on the ground. It's like a ski resort, giant mountain range.
Unless William Fichtner, he spent so much money to make a weather dominator. Wherever he lives, it's just winter all year long.
Yes. That's the only explanation that makes sense, because like it's just like there's nowhere within this like circle of the radius of like where they're saying this takes place, where you'd have a spring summer in New York City, and then like snow covered mountains,
like an unbelievable. Like it's really distracting because all they had to do was say, "Hey, let's just go see this guy who doesn't live in New York," but they really wanted to tie it in. It's as if like they filmed that scene first and went, "Oh shit." This movie takes place in New York City.
Why couldn't they make why not make it winter in New York City too? Like it wouldn't affect anything really. Like
crazy, it wouldn't affect the story. It's not like it's a Christmas movie. It's not like the snow was the secret to something.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really distracting because that act comes in and it's very meaningless in the end. It's not like you discovered something super important. That it was winter.
It's only
winter place.
It's only winter for the big action sequence because then they're like they're sliding down the mountain and like it's like that's like the whole point of why they needed snow. Which is just like
but here's the thing, I've seen the sequel and it's like for whatever one act they leave the country, right? Mm-hmm. And that's good writing. It's like let's do a scene by like a giant river. New York doesn't have a giant river. So we'll just go to it and sort of explain in the movie why we had to go to it. Good. This was like, I want a scene where they do sledding. It's like, okay, well, it's spring. Okay, so no, that one area of New York just has great sledding weather.
Mm-hmm. That place where it's always snowing, even if it's like the middle of summer.
Yeah, and it's a drivable. And has great public sewer access.
Yes, sewers connected directly to New York City. I'm like, that you could slide through.
Where is this? Like, if the movie sort of pointed it out, or if it's like, hey, no, this place actually exists, we should probably mention it, you know? Like, or it's like, hey, you heard about that freak weather? Okay. You know, like, something.
Mm-hmm.
Instead, they went with the, he just lives in perpetual rich guy mansion housing. I don't know. Super weird. It's still like upsetting because I'm like, man, that really distracts you. It's a cool sequence.
Mm.
It just doesn't make sense to the rest of the movie, which is a great statement for this whole movie.
Because the rest of everyone's just like walking around in like light jackets or not even just like t-shirts, and then because there's the whole thing where like April is like basically like Veronica Corningstone, like she's just getting like these like super fluffy like non stories at the Channel 6, but she wants to be like a real reporter. So that's why she's like investigating the Foot Clan, and she witnesses like this like break in at like this or like they're trying to like steal something at like the docks, and then she gets like her first glimpse of the turtles, but then And then she like sees the she, there's like they, the turtles leave a symbol every time they stop a crime apparently, and then there's an like probably the one of the craziest things in this movie besides like the weird like weather patterns is that, and I don't think it's ever been in any other Turtles thing is that April is like directly tied to like the origin of the turtles and was like.
Oh my God.
They were her pets in because they were like her father's lab experiments, but she basically treated them as like her pets too.
Super like I didn't care for it so much, but the more I think about it, the more I'm upset about it because it's like she knew these turtles, she saved them from this horrific fire that took the life of her father, and she just like forgets what their name were.
Yeah, they were like so like burned. They should have been burned into her memory. But then I guess she thought they died. Well, she saved them, so I guess she just like assumed they would just like live in like the sewers and she would never see them again.
Mm-hmm. I get it, but the crazy thing is like, when she hears their name, she has to like see some footage when she was like 12 and like remember that.
Well, that's I'm like, yeah, hearing the names is what jocks remember, not like seeing like, hey, they're these weird turtle creatures. My dad was experimenting on turtles. Are they the same turtles? Maybe. I need to go read like my dad's research documents that I have and then like, watch like home video footage.
What are the odds these mutant turtles are the same turtles I helped take care for?
that are named after Renaissance painters.
and I'm named Zach. Colored yes. The way she colored them.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
I do like for the secret science lab, she was able to bring in a camcorder that also survived the fire, or she brought that home, all the footage.
Like, and also,
the footage also was labeled with the turtles' name on it, too.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And also, like, they're doing, like, this, like, I'm assuming top secret research, but then, like, William Fichtner's like, oh, yeah, sure, I'll entertain this, like, 10-year-old girl by doing an interview talking about our research, like...
Yeah, you want to know how we made this mutagen? It came from space.
she has footage of, like, the ooze, the TCRI ooze.
It's like, shouldn't that be behind a wall or something, or, like...
Would you
out of like, a glass box,
or would you let your daughters like wander around like we're doing this like high secret like genetic experiments?
I get it that it's your partner's daughter, right? It's your business partner, science partner's like daughter, but there's still like a security breach where like this unauthorized footage has been filmed here. Like
she's feeding the pizza, which would like wouldn't that like?
Oh my god!
You're supposed to have like a controlled environment for like because for this experiment. It's just like here, hey guys, eat some pizza. Like,
and they're like, hey, who? In reality, I think if you give turtle pizza,
they're probably dead.
It won't die, but it can't digest probably all that dairy. So it's gonna be like, oh, why is their turtle really sick?
But yeah, it's so nuts that like so much of like their like origins come from April, like the colors and the pizza and
the names, the love, the Hogashi,
yes, because Splinter tells the boys that like, oh, we were saved by a guardian spirit that like brought us to the sewers,
and they're like, it was Megan Fox.
Yeah, here she is. I do love, like, one thing that I do love about this movie is especially like in the first act, like how Megan Fox basically turns into like Charlie Day from It's Always Sunny when trying to unravel a conspiracy, and like everyone just treats her like a maniac. And she's like acting like a maniac. She's like, there's turtles. They're in. I named them. I named them Renaissance painters. They're experiments. Turtles. Ninjas. And then Whoopi Goldberg's just like, you're fired. Like, get out of here.
Oh, it's like, you gotta stop doing drugs at work.
She literally makes a conspiracy board. She makes a conspiracy board of like that, and she shows Whoopi Goldberg, who's like the editor or like the chief editor in chief of Channel 6. It's like just like the only thing, I don't think she has red string attached to anything, but it's basically the red, like a red string conspiracy board. It was like, look at turtles, ninjas, ooze. I made them.
Okay, is it crazier that I forgot Whoopi Goldberg's in this movie?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
She comes out of nowhere. She's in for two scenes. and it's just kind of distracting because it's like she's just playing Whoopi Goldberg. You know, she's not playing a character. She's just there, and then she's the one who has to say, "Hey, Megan Fox, you drew a crazy board. You have to fire. This is an HR nightmare if I don't fire you."
Mm-hmm.
All the coworkers around us are getting concerned.
There's also that scene like Megan Fox's roommate, who apparently like is just like she, her roommate just walks in and she and Megan Fox just starts yelling at her about like, "I knew it. They were I named them. I named the turtles." And then she's just like, "Mom, I want to leave. Like, my roommate's a psycho." So I did laugh at like the like, yeah, Megan Fox is just like insane insanity.
Like, is that roommate supposed to be the same character that was in the TMNT cartoon show? Like,
I don't even think like, what is that character's name even? I don't even know. Like, God. Taylor, I think is according to Wikipedia, it's definitely not like a cartoon character.
I'm gonna check it out real quick.
I'm surprised they pulled Vern in. Like, that seems like a deep cut to pull from like the cartoon. I mean, he was a pretty regular series character, but
you know what I mean? Like, okay, so there's Vern. He was like snooty, and you see less and less of him.
Oh yeah, Will Arnett is like not even trying to be. It's name only Vern. Like, he's just Will Arnett. He's doing his regular Will Arnett thing.
Irma.
It's definitely not Irma. No.
Irma Langston.
Mm-hmm.
Langstein, who, like, I guess she never got, like, a contemporary remake character, but that could be Irma, but it's not.
Nope, it's just some random girl who somehow became Megan Fox's roommate. But yeah, but eventually April does, like, she does meet the Turtles and finds out that they're alive, and then Splinter remembers everything apparently, and like tells them like hey boys, it's been like, you know, 10 years or whatever, 20 15 years or whatever, but I'll tell you the actual origin story now that Megan Fox is here. And also I was surprised because like the because Mutant Mayhem did the same thing, but like Splinter learns ninjutsu from a book that like washed into like the sewer.
Who are these people who
just
are
flushing a martial arts instruction manual down the toilet?
And they're effective.
Yeah.
Like, I get that, like, these days probably learning martial arts from a book is not recommended, but this is something where these basic 101 ninjutsu books are being flushed down the sewer, and they are very good.
Yeah,
I think Mutant Mayhem, I think, was it like a video I think he watched.
Yeah, like Jackie Chan's Twitter finds like they find like instructional video. Like, he basically finds like Tiger. Tiger Shulman videos, basically. Yeah.
Well, Tiger Shulman is the karate school, but
yeah,
I know what you mean. Like, it's just like VHS self defense courses. But
yeah,
they're not supposed to teach you like ninjutsu. Like, it's not practical things.
Yeah. I mean the. Splinter in this movie becomes like he becomes so fucking good. Like, he's like every weapon, I do love that he uses his tail, as a weapon, which is like, I don't
it's
think
basically
I
another I limb.
Yeah, no, I don't think another Splinter has ever done that in like our adaptation. So that's like a cool touch.
I see, like, it's got good moments with Splinter. I do enjoy his like story, and I was shocked because I kind of remember him being like an insult, especially when he's explaining like pizza. But no, when he fights, when there's a thing where he's taking on the Foot Clan and he's whipping them around, and then he's agile, he becomes like a bigger size Yoda.
Yeah,
it's great. Like, him trying to fight a Transformer Shredder in the sewer. Great scene. Particularly for me, it just seems like the fighting style is frantic. You know, like, how do you fight a rat? Like, you know, do you think you go for the head? You really don't, because it's fast. And then he has like bigger arms than you think, you know, for a rat.
Yeah,
he's got monkey arms for a rat. It's very weird. The more I think of it, it's like, it's very creepy. I get why the humans don't know what to do trying to box with a rat. But
And
it kind of has that problem where like they explain too much, and by doing that, it ruins the whole like mystique, because it's like it's not like he was an Asian rat, you know?
Yeah,
he just found shit in the sewer and just decided to become Asian.
It's voiced by Tony Shalhoub.
Yeah, so this is all sorts of weird in that sense, because I'm like, at least the original one, the original comic was he was the Asian, he was a pet to Oroku Saki, not Oroku Saki, but
the
guy was. Mm-hmm. So he was a Japanese rat that got brought to New York. Fine, right? And then in the cartoon, he was a Japanese man who got turned into a rat.
Yes.
Fine. And then even the Jackie Chan one, I think, like, he wasn't Japanese. Like, he didn't have, like, the traditional, like, sensei outfit. I think because, like, he didn't find anything. That's why it was, like, funny, because he just had shit laying around. And then all the things that kept getting flushed on the sewer just happened to be Asian shit. And he's just like, I don't know, I'm a rat. Like, whatever. Like, I have to survive. So, that.
Yeah, the Jackie Chan Splinter just learned from, like, cry instructional VHSs and then, like actual Jackie Chan movies, I think. They show, like actual, like, Jackie Chan movie at one point.
Plus, like, yeah, so you probably learn language through Jackie Chan movies. So, like, you know, like, that's how he got the way he is.
Mm-hmm.
This, Tony Shalhoub rat, makes no sense. Like, every turtle sounds like different turtles, like, different accents from, like, California, like, New York. You know, mostly California. I think Mikey and Raph have, like, maybe Raph is New York.
Well, Raph is Jersey? Alan Richson. Raph is Alan Richson, Jack Reacher. Mm-hmm. Which, in retrospect, I'm like, oh, that's perfect casting, because Raph is the Jack Reacher of the Turtles, so. And then Johnny Knoxville is Leonardo.
So weird. So weird to see him, like, stoic sounding.
Yeah. And then, yeah, I think yeah, Noel Fisher from Shameless is Michelangelo. And then Jeremy Howard, who's been in a bunch of stuff, is Donatello. I do appreciate, like, the turtles have, like, the sort of distinct, like, looks. Like, they all of them have, like, their own, like, they've, like, kind of cultivated their own, like, you know, style. Like, Leonardo
whatever they could find.
He's got, like, the bamboo armor. Like, Raph has, like, a bandana and sunglasses. And then, like, Michelangelo has, like, puku shells. And Donatello has all his, like, you know, it's tech shit, because he does machines.
He's wearing a Ghostbuster backpack.
Yes. And, yeah,
I do appreciate that. Like, that, but that's all shit either they made, found, or stole.
But that's kind of, like, the limit of, like, the, establishing their personalities is, like, hey, they wear different things. And they're different sizes.
Not wrong.
Like, Mutant Mayhem did such a good job of, like, making them all, like, have, like, unique personalities.
And, yeah, without the clothes explaining it.
Yeah. Because they're all, it's the bare bones, like, TMNT, personalities. Like, Raph is mad, Leonardo's a boring leader, Donatello's a nerd, Mikey is a weird pervert. Like,
oh my god.
I guess that one is not the traditional Mikey personality. I don't know what the hell is going on with it. Like, he's just like, all Mikey does in this movie just constantly just hit on April. That's all he does.
And she's okay with it. You figure after a while she, like, pull him aside and be like, all right, we gotta talk if we're gonna work together.
It's weird too, because, like, by the end she's like, oh, we're family, but then Mikey's still hitting on her, because, like, he's like, April's basically like their sister or their mom. Mother? I don't know how that works out, of like, they were her pets, but, like,
usually you are the owner of a pet, you're their parent.
Yeah, so that's just weird. Like, the psychological issues going on there are large.
Mikey's got maybe an Oedipus
Oedipus complex, yeah.
Oedipus. I get it. I don't support it, but I get it.
Mm-hmm. And then, like, Vern's also, like, constantly hitting on her. It's like Megan
this
Fox.
The movie was to see how many scenes we can have Megan Fox feel like want it.
Well, it's so weird, because she left the Transformers franchise, and there's like conflicting like reports of like, was she fired? Did she like leave like voluntarily? Like that was the whole thing. But then she came back to like be on a Michael Bay movie. It's just, like she's not as like it's not like as over the top like insane as like Transformers 2 or 1, where she's like lying over a motorcycle or anything. But it's still like, no, there's a shot where she's like leaning on the van, like Will Ferrell's like looking at her ass, and like that opening where she's like in the trampoline class, and it's like he's still doing it. Michael Bay's still doing it. Yeah.
Oh man.
You can't.
Think... I remember that scene.
Wait, which one?
Yeah, it's like I remember these scenes. It's like after a while you start noticing it, and you're like, all right. Yep. Did Megan Fox has made this movie? Because I know now she's got like a personality, is very narcissistic, but yeah, this movie is just the Megan Fox movie starring like the Turtles.
Yeah, because the Turtles like don't show up in like full for like probably like 30-40 minutes. At least, like, because, like, you only see, like, you can see the barest glimpse of them, and then it's, like, they don't show up until, like, that scene on the roof where they meet April.
Huh. I don't know. Is that long?
It's definitely quite a while. I mean, it's got to be at least 30 minutes, if not, like, close to, like, 40, 45 minutes. There's, because they stop that, like, subway hostage situation where the Foot Clan are trying to, like, lure them out. It's like, we'll take hostages, they'll have to come out, and then they get their asses kicked.
What a bad plan. It's like, hey, let's pick a random subway in the hopes that they will arrive in time.
They've seen them like toss like shipping containers like they're like a toy. So it's like, yeah, let's lure these like unknown super strong like vigilantes into like the subway.
Where basically the Foot Clan have a bad tactical advantage.
Yeah.
And then, they should have brought, like, a mech suit or something.
Well,
they should have outfitted an army full of, like, shredder suits.
Yeah, why did Sax make, like, them, like, just, or at least give them some sort of, like, you know, tech weapon, like, give them lasers or something, or, like, arm gauntlets or something, yeah. Give Karai something, like, Karai gets her ass kicked.
Karai should be, like, in a hospital body cast. She gets pounded into a wall.
She gets slammed in by, like, Raph, I think, into a wall. Raph, the biggest turtle, in his, like, bulletproof shell, like, slams her into a wall.
She
never gets, like you think she would have, like, some sort of, like, fight with, like, one of them, like, Leonardo or something, but, like, she just doesn't, no, she's, like, in the Jeep. Like, she doesn't, like, fight any of them directly.
Yeah, I realize that even in the sequel, she doesn't fight the Turtles directly anymore.
Yeah.
I also saw the sequel right after this. That's why I was talking about that.
Well, I mean, the sequel is like, so much better than this first one. Because they finally realized, like, we should go full cartoon and just have, like, you know, Bebop, Rocksteady, Casey Jones, Krang, Baxter Stockman, like an actual turtle van.
They embraced it. Which is weird, because you figure, okay, you're doing a whole reboot series, embrace the fandom, embrace like the stuff that the fans came to love, but it's like, yeah, no, and Megan Fox. Megan Fox is what we're going to embrace now. Look how cool she is.
And a mecha, like a Transformer Shredder.
So disappointed.
Who, I don't even understand like how the physics work, or like he shoots blades out and they just fly back somehow, like magnets, I guess. Yeah. But he has like an unlimited supply of them.
No, I think it's limited because he has to recall them.
Yeah. I do appreciate that he says at one point like tonight I die in turtle soup.
Yeah.
Like they do drop some like you know turtle like classic turtle lines in there like. Sprinkled in there, but yeah, it's definitely this first one is definitely not as much like a fan service or like trying to appeal to fans as like the second one.
I think they were trying to be hip. Like the market was weird because I feel like,
well, I mean,
a good one third of this movie is just marketing material between Dunkin' Donuts, Pizza Hut. And I saw another brand in there.
I don't think there's any car deals or anything.
No, in the next one they do.
Yeah.
I think that's definitely why they didn't get, like, a car deal for this one.
Yeah, definitely Pizza Hut is definitely, like, there's, like, a full, there's an entire scene where Splinter tries, is, like, teasing them with Pizza Hut.
Here's the insane thing. It's, like, why make a fake pizza for the scene?
Yeah.
Like, shouldn't they just do some sort of, like...
What was it? It was, like, the pizza with, like, 99 cheeses on it or something?
Yep. Mm-hmm. It's, like, the 99 cheese pizza, and then it's, like, he got to three toppings, three cheeses, and then Mikey broke.
Yeah. Can you imagine if they actually made like a are there even 99 cheeses you could put on a pizza? Like
I think maybe there's 50 good pizzas because like you can put cream cheese on a pizza.
Yeah,
it's a good pizza.
It's some cheese won't melt, so it's like
most cheeses will melt. It's just high temperature, so you have to cook this pizza at different degrees at different points to like melt the cheese. You know what I mean? It just
they should try to
pre-melt it.
They should have tried to make like one like they had a, have a contest or something. And we're gonna make one of these like 99 cheese pizzas and like you have to be the first one to like this New York City like pizza butt or something.
I'm just thinking like, can you make a 99 cheese pizza?
I have to look on like YouTube. Like there's all those guys that like make like the food from like TV shows. Like someone trying to make a 99 cheese pizza from Turtles 2014.
Okay, I looked it up online. In 2014, someone in Australia did attempt to make a 99 cheese pizza.
Oh, man.
Okay, and there's an article about it, and someone did it as a stunt. They saw TMNT in theaters, like us,
yep,
and had exactly this conversation, and then he credited the movie. And then, yeah, because it has so much fucking cheese on it, Zach, it's a white pizza. Essentially, there's no sauce. Like, it's just cheese sauce. Johnny DeFrancesco, an Australian chef, made the 99 cheese pizza, and I'm not sure if it's good or not because I think it's just so much nonsense flavors at that point.
Yeah, I think it's like the only like it's the only time, only like big pizza promotion in this movie.
And it was not even like a real pizza.
No, there's like a flashback where like they do like a Leonardo's cutting the pizza that like flops on like Splinter's head when like the little turtles.
I mean, the marketing for it was kind of crazy because it's like, oh, this is the pizza that like rodents and reptiles love, Pizza Hut.
I can't remember if they did like, because I know in From Mutant Mayhem they did like the, it's like each turtle gets their own pizza. I think they did something like that for this one, where it's like Raph is always like, it's like 10 meats. Raph likes meats. Like Leonardo likes veggies because he's boring. But yeah, but anyway, so yeah, one of the things I was trying to figure out was like, how did they find the turtle's lair? And I think it was, did they use
her cell phone?
The cell phone. I thought at first it was like the business card that like Sax gives her. It's like, hey, call me, we'll figure this out. it seemed like that had like a microchip in it or something to like track her. But yeah, I guess it was a cell phone.
Smart, but he does that to everyone because he didn't know April would be useful until way later.
Yeah.
They say it really quick in a throwaway line. They're like, all right, we're pinging the cell phone, and it's like, now let's converge on it. Like triangulate.
But, yeah, and then they have like Dark Knight style, echo. Like, it's just like, they see like the x-ray of like the lair, basically. They can see like everyone inside.
They were able to map it out. I don't know if that's like a real thing they saw, or that was just like the cool Michael Bay visual to say, oh, this is what we think a ping effect is.
But yeah, but that's like one of the biggest...
would be like overloaded if her phone was pinging that much, where it was mapping out a room, her battery would be drained.
Yeah, and like no one else has like a the turtles don't have cell phones, I don't think.
Maybe they do.
Donnie probably does. Donnie is loaded with tech. But One of the big sequences is the Foot Clan attacks the lair, and it's like shockingly all the turtles get captured except for Raph, and then so then it basically becomes like a Raph solo movie for like a little bit when did The Last Ronin come out? Because I feel like this like there's a little bit of like an homage to like Last Ronin where it's like Raph picks up all the weapons of the other turtles and like puts them on his like shell.
2016.
So maybe that'd be so weird to inspire by like Kevin Eastman was like inspired by this, like, hey, that's a good idea.
What if there was one turtle that had to carry on
all the weapons?
Everyone?
Yeah.
It'd be the best out of all of them. Which, mm-hmm. Really sad story. But I can't wait for the Last Ronin shit. Like, take it the series to a whole new direction.
Yeah, we're getting that like God of War style game soon, I think. But yeah, Raph is definitely like the star of this movie, I think, far as the turtles go. It's like Raph and April are the stars.
You figured it'd be Leonardo just because he has that, like, oh, it's so hard to be the leader in front of these people. But
yeah.
No, Raph actually, the beginning of the third act is pretty cool because it's like Raph and he has to figure out how to do all things and then he has to bully his way to fake upstate New York.
Yep. Mm-hmm. They barely get into like the like Leonardo Raph like fight, like it's like they have like one scene of like, oh, you always gotta be the leader or whatever, and then that's it. they don't really get into that at all.
Well, I guess because this movie's packed with so much plot, you can't have that at this point.
Yeah, but then they had like the crazy like, oh, like the emotional ending of like they're like they're gonna die, so they're all confessing stuff, and like Raph has like his big like emotional speech about how he loves his brothers.
Yeah, I'm good scene.
Mm-hmm.
There are moments that I feel like the writer really was going through something. So they like really wrote like a real well like spoken dialogue scene that should not be in this TMNT movie.
Mm-hmm.
Cause it really like makes it dramatic. Like they're all talking about nonsense on the way down and then Raph is like, all right, well, let's have some group therapy.
Yeah.
Like, I'm sorry, cool
I'm, I, didn't I'm sorry I was it, a bully. But... Like, I was pushing you guys because I was scared. I was scared that it was going to be good enough.
Tough guy don't cry.
Yeah. But yeah, the whole Raph breaking into the Sax estate and then freaking all the other like he's fighting Shredder he's losing, but then April injects all the other turtles with, like, adrenaline, like, an overdose of adrenaline, and it's basically they're on cocaine.
I don't think, like, that replaces blood.
No, they lost a ton of blood, yeah.
But then they would just fall asleep. Like, I think you'd be hyper, but then eventually you'll crash, which they never do. At this point the movie, from them, a lack of blood, they don't eat, they're not drinking anything, and then they're not making more blood. You know, like, it's sort of like... You should be passed out. You all lost like pints of blood, maybe like
quite a bit. I mean,
quite to fill a canister, at least two canisters.
Yeah. And then Sax's whole plan is that he and Shredder are going to unleash a virus, like a toxin, on New York, kill like I forgot how many people, like 30,000 people, or like that's like some sort of like insane amount of people in New York City. But then he's gonna swoop in with the cure that he's gonna use based on the mutagen, and save whoever's left, and then he'll be like his company will be like, he's gonna sell it to the government, or like he's gonna sell it. It's like a cure, and then his company will make money. But then also
forever.
But then also Shredder will take over the city.
I guess it'll be their rule. So it's like, hey, you made the pharmaceutical thing, so now you can rule Manhattan.
New York? Like, yeah. I don't think it works that way. I don't think the government's gonna, like, let you, like, oh, you saved people? Like, it's your city now. Go ahead. Yeah, like...
You police it now. Like, this pharmacy company will now dictate the fire department, the transportation department.
this pharmaceutical company and this army of mercenaries are gonna run New York City
ninja,
now.
Ninja mercenaries.
Yeah.
Supposed ninja mercenaries are now going to tell you when the trains are going to run.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, not a very well thought out plan, but that is the plan. And then we get that whole crazy snow mountain chase that we were talking about earlier, with like where they're like blowing up, they're like hitting jeeps and making them fly. Like, it's Werner's driving like a tractor trailer down a mountain, and then the turtles like are sliding behind the tractor trailer on their shells.
I mean, it was cool. It's cool. It's piece. It just doesn't make sense to the rest of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
I just wish it didn't come out of left field, just for like to fit in. Because I get it. Whatever the evil compound was, because it was a mansion slash lab slash like transportation depot.
Yeah. Slash like ninja dojo, because where Shredder was.
Yeah, they had a ninja dojo there.
Yeah.
So a lot was going on in that area, so they just made it snowy and for miles, nothing, just mountaintop range.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, only thing that's nearest is that sewer access that will lead you to Manhattan faster than a helicopter.
Yeah, because they get there basically the exact same time as like Sax gets back to New York City, and they're like. Like he's like pumping the just starting to do the mutagen, and like they're like, hey, we're back, we found you, like. And then we get like April and Vern have to fight Sax, and then the turtles have to fight Shredder, and the turtles get their asses beaten by Shredder for like most of that fight.
It's pretty funny, just because they have no strategy, and it takes them like 3 rounds to figure that out.
They have to remember that childhood game they played, Buck-Buck.
Buck-Buck.
That's the key to everything.
Where you basically attack one at a time, but
you get progressively higher. That's the strategy that Shredder is like, he's unable to stop. Yeah.
But okay, so that makes sense to an enemy that has mostly a ground game. So his weakness is like air attacks, but Shredder has homing missiles. Like, he has homing knives.
Yeah.
So air attacks are meaningless. He can still, like, throw things, and he can still, like... He'll let you attack up, because he's got, like, an arm's length of knives. And he's got Wolverine claws and, like, flying knives. So
he's got,
he wants you to air attack.
He's got, like, Predator blades, and then he can spread out, like, his, like, knife-throwing knives, and, like, he has those, too.
He's a walking blender, so
yes,
like, that's fine. Like, I don't know. Like, later on, I guess it's like the Turtles aren't ready to fight a Transformer.
Yeah,
and the suit itself has so many questions, because if you remember the beginning of the movie when you see Oroku Saki as the just regular like man,
yep, mm-hmm.
And he is like 7 feet tall or more. Like, he's a giant man. William Fichtner is like 6'1". Like, he's not short. So, I'm thinking Oroku Saki to be a head taller is like 7-something. And then he puts on the mech suit to become easily like 9 feet tall. Right? He's bigger than the turtles, at least.
Yeah, and I think April says the turtles are 6 foot, like, they're all like 6 foot tall at least. So...
So, yeah, I'm just thinking, like, all right. Then he gets thrown off a roof and survives?
Yeah. He gets thrown off a skyscraper. And I guess because the mutagen, like, he got a little bit of the mutagen on him, and then, like, that, like, healed him or, like, kept him from dying.
The sequel sort of just says, all right, this is Shredder. Just go with it.
He's Brian T now. Like, he's not a giant bald man anymore.
And he's just so much better, like, Shredder looking than the mech suit.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, it has its moments. Because honestly, I do like the camaraderie between the turtles, the dialogue where they make fun of each other, or they're like off on their like bro ship. So it's like, you know, they're still like learning.
I know a lot of people like point out even though it's like so out of place against anything it's like happened before, but it's like an actual like good like scene of them being like goofy brothers, like when they're in the elevator, they do like the they do like the like hype up rap.
Yep, I enjoyed that. It's out of nowhere. It doesn't really add anything, but it's a fun like moment between them, and I guess like it's what they do before a battle. So I'm fine with it. Nothing beats the live action 1989 or 1990 TMNT movie where it's just a battle and they just go for it. And then they're just these poor stuntmen in rubber suits who are throwing themselves around the rooftop.
Yeah.
This, however, is just like so much CGI things are going on. Sometimes it's followable. Like sometimes it's a cool, like, okay, you could see the action. Like, this is too hard to film in real life, so they can in this cartoon sequence.
Yeah, this action is definitely better than, like, the, like, Transformers movies, at least. Like, because Michael Bay, like, just puts, like, the camera, it's like, the camera's in, like, Megatron's armpit, and you have to, like, look through, like, his, like arm, like, through, like, his, like, circuitry, to, like, and then you see Optimus Prime, like, barely coming at him or something. It's just, like, The Transformers action is such so horribly, especially in the last couple movies, where it's just like incoherent nonsense.
You saw the Beast Wars one, right?
I mean that it's not Michael Bay, so it's better.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, Bumblebee and Rise of the Beast are both like way better than anything of like the last like four like four Transformers movies or whatever.
I still gotta see them.
Dark of the Moon is like, I mean, it's way too fucking long, but that's like the last like halfway decent one, and then all the other ones after that are just like, brain hurting garbage. It's like where it's like you're actually feeling yourself get stupider watching them.
You heard it here, folks. Zach says brain rotting garbage for this for Michael Bay Transformers.
Yeah, you want to simulate like what it like if you got a concussion, or you want to like, give your brain like a concussion with a movie, like yeah, watch like The Last Night or whatever. But yeah, this one's fine. The sequel is definitely so much better just because of like, yeah, it leans so much more into like the cartoons that more characters like our tune and yeah, like yeah, it's all a bunch of characters you actually want to see. Never been in a movie before, and they finally showed up like Bebop and Rocksteady and Krang and all that stuff. So,
I know like Netflix. I watched this movie on Netflix, and it was like, hey, let's immediately play the second one. I was like, all right, you got it.
Mm-hmm.
So when I was watching this back to back, it was a great time. You know, kill 2.5 hours just watching this. I learned a lot about my love of TMNT. I know I'm like a snob where I will say the first two live action movies are really hard to top. This is better than the third movie. Third movie is just like, I don't know. Third movie, you gotta be in the mood to watch that one and really enjoy it.
That's in the like so bad it's good category. Like, yeah, it's absolutely terrible. Like,
I love the concept of time travel. You know me, I like time travel things. However, yeah. I mean, TMNT time travel, times. Yeah. Somehow in Japan, they made a magic lamp.
Yep.
Doesn't explain how it's made. It's just a scepter. No one does it anything good with it. And it's just there.
And nothing changed historically that these, like, four samurai guys, like, learned all about, like, the modern world and came back.
They're realistic. They went to the future, then they go back, and then it's like, we're gonna do that. What do you do with that knowledge? Like, they learn nothing.
Well, they basically just learned how to like party with Casey. That's all I did, basically. You just like took them around, like, hey, you guys want to hang out? Like,
well, people forget like samurais, as noble as they are, they're not educated like that. You know what I mean? Like, their whole focus was like battle and poetry, and then maybe like how to respect your local governor. So when they have none of that, no safeguards, like, yeah, all they want to do is just drink beer and fight.
Mm-hmm.
And then learn hockey. Yeah, man, samurais aren't that great. But yeah, Do you remember the soundtrack to this movie? Because it will remind you at the end.
Like 2014 one? Well, I mentioned it in the intro, but yeah, like that end credits song, like Shell Shock. It's like,
knock, knock, you're about to get your shell shock.
I appreciate how stupid it is in the, it's like referencing the movie. Like it's like a throwback to like, you know, like Turtle Power, but it's definitely not as good as Turtle Power or like Ninja Rap or anything.
So I forgot how weird that song was because it caught me off guard because it's not like it's used a lot in the movie.
It explodes during the credits. You're like, wait, what the hell is this? Like,
yeah. So it's like, oh man, I forgot about this.
They don't even start playing it in like their like proto turtle van at the end. They're playing like Happy Together.
Yep, they're playing a turtle song.
Because like Donnie like mentions all the like well, we got Bose speakers and everything, and it's like you think that like yeah, blast like your. Wiz Khalifa like rap theme, but
no, they play literally the Turtles made Happy Forever. So I'm like, mm-hmm. Oh, yep. That's clever.
And it's so weird to see, like that like van at the end is also like it feels like a go kart compared to like the actual like van they get in the second one.
The second one was a garbage truck.
Yeah. But it's like how like that one at the end of this movie like feels like so small. It's like and you see how huge the turtles are in this movie. It's just like how are y'all fitting in there and like not being cramped. Like it's just like it's like a delivery van or something that they've chopped.
I think when they go in, they have to be in their shell. Like there's no way.
Maybe yeah. Because it rolls up and you're like. Wait, are they? Is this like a go kart? Like the turtle cart?
It's a clown car.
Yeah.
Any thoughts about how they could have improved this movie?
I mean, well, I think the second one did the improvements. Just like you know, have more characters for the cartoon and make it more like appeal to fans and not have and kind of like lean away from like this the weird origin stories that like they created and some of the Michael Bayness.
Yeah, I'm about the same way. I kind of prefer a TMNT movie that is turtle first and then mention April. This was like an April movie that happens to have turtles like come in.
Yeah. I mean, we're definitely in a very good spot now with like Mutant Mayhem. That's like their you know current turtles.
I still gotta see this TV show. I heard the TV show's okay.
I mean, we're recording this; it's not even out yet. So people now it's out if you're hearing this. But we're in the past, and it's not out yet. But I think it's getting good reviews as far, at the time of recording this. So I think I read it's a little bit more like. Younger skewing even than like the movie was, so it might be like it's more like a kid's show, but apparently it's still
they solve
like,
all their problems with hugs,
maybe. I don't know, like, but I think I read there's still some like fun stuff for Turtles fans too, so I'm definitely gonna check it out at some point.
I like that, I like to hear that,
but yeah, a weird time in the world of Turtles where there's this these gritty roided out monsters were the Turtles for like 2 years, because like it was 2014 was this movie, 2016 was the next movie. But yeah, they're stronger than ever now, with like Mayhem and all the other stuff that's going on. So the turtles will never die. And so they'll wrap this week for Turtles 2014. Next week we're gonna be talking about Alien versus Predator. Which is celebrating its 20th anniversary next week, and it's also going to it also kind of ties into we're getting a new Alien movie, Alien Romulus, which will hopefully kind of bring the franchise back to like you know its Aliens roots. But we're talking about like, the weird crazy battle that people wanted for years and then totally disappointed everyone.
Yeah, people still wanted it.
That was like Frey. It was Frey versus Jason, and it was Alien versus Predator. Those are the two things people wanted to see, and both kind of disappointed people after like how much like build up there was to those movies. But then somehow the Alien versus Predator got a sequel. So But we're talking about the first one. And, you know, the crazy Antarctic training ground for the Predators, all that stuff next week. So come back for that. And head over to the site. We all sorts of news, reviews, trailers. I got a review of the new M. Night Shyamalan movie, Trap. If you want to read my review of that, it's up on the site. We've got all of our... We got trailers, we got news, we got commentaries up there. You can listen to our commentary from last month, which is Superman 4, The Quest for Peace. We're going to have a new one up soon this month as well. So check all that stuff up over the site. And yeah, so for Chris, I'm Zach, and we will see you next week.
For more from Everything Action, head to www.everythingaction.com. You can also find us on Facebook at facebook.com/everything.action and follow us on X at EVAction. We're also on Instagram and Threads at everything.action. Find more episodes of the podcast on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or your podcast app of choice, and be sure to rate and subscribe.